This video is a Buster Call. To find out more about how you can get me to do a personalized video on a topic of your choosing, head over to patreon.com/grandlinereview and scroll down to the Admiral tier. But for now, enjoy the video. Don't you dare speak lightly of sinking this island. This fortress of justice has protected the world seas for hundreds of years. For all of the citizens in the world who fear an invasion of evildoers, justice and righteousness will never be defeated. Hello and welcome to One Piece 101, the series that breaks down everyone and everything in the One Piece world. Today we are going to be examining a long overdue faction and one of the primary antagonistic forces in the series, the Marines. The Marine organization is the primary militaristic branch of the world government, charged with defensive and offensive operations as well as maintaining general law enforcement around and within the nations contained within the world government. As such, the Marines comprise the largest organized force in the entire series, and while their exact numbers are unknown, prior to the time skip it was at least 100,000 members strong, as that was said to be the amount of soldiers gathered to fight during the Paramount War. Of course, when not at war, this massive quantity of soldiers are dispatched to maintain a presence within every major part of the One Piece world, including the four blue seas. However, the bulk of their forces are stationed across the Grand Line and the New World in order to combat the widespread threat of piracy, as well as carry out whatever orders are given to them from their less than benevolent overlords, the Celestial Dragons. And while this makes them a major antagonist to us as the audience, within the world the Marines are publicly viewed as the good guys, fighting on behalf of the people. And that's not entirely without good reason, as this organization is so vast that it contains an incredible amount of individuals who actively fight for their own personal sense of justice, and at any given time there are internal struggles between those who support more morally based justice versus those who prefer the idea of absolute justice, which is basically the belief and willingness to sacrifice anything for the sake of defeating quote-unquote evil. Whatever you subscribe to though, justice is the main driving force behind the enlisted men and women of the Marines, to the point where the kanji for justice, Seigi, is emblazoned on the coats of all commissioned officers as a staunch reminder of what they're fighting for. Now what do I mean by commissioned officers? Well, I'm thrilled that you asked that, because that brings us into the extensive ranking system within the Marines, which are broadly illustrated by the three following categories. You have the Infantry and Sailor Division, commissioned officers, and special rankings. Ooh. But we'll start right at the bottom with the Infantry and Sailor Division, which generally consists of people who have enlisted in the Marines without any prior training or experience. And the very lowest rank within this group here is the wonderful role of Chore Boy. I'm sure their purpose is pretty clear judging by the name, but they exist to maintain the integrity of Marine spaces and equipment. Moving on from there, we have a set of three Seaman-based ranks, being Seaman Recruit, Seaman Apprentice, and Seaman First Class. These more or less encompass the lowest ranks that can be held by Marines who are trained and expected to participate in combative missions. Although the functional differences between these ranks are unknown, and in fact so far there hasn't been a single named character in the series who even holds the rank of Seaman Apprentice in particular. Then next up we have a gaggle of Petty Officer ranks, including Petty Officer, Chief Petty Officer, and Master Chief Petty Officer, the latter of which is a rank that both Kobe and Tashigi have held. And finally, the highest rank one can hold in the Infantry and Sailor Division is that of Warrant Officer, which at the time of this recording no named Marine has held. But from there we jump into the upper echelon with the Commissioned Marine Officers. This group consists of a further 11 ranks, the holders of which have been granted special authority and leadership by the world government. And quite notably, every officer within this group is given the right to wear the Seigi Kanji on the backs of their clothing, the introductory rank of which is Ensign, followed by a set of lieutenants, including Lieutenant Junior Grade, a regular role lieutenant, and Lieutenant Commander, a rank which is currently held by the increasingly awesome Helmeppo. After which though comes the Commander rank, which is obtained by Don Quixote Rocinante prior to his tragic death. And then we have Captain. Now we know a ton of captains, including Very Good, T-Bone, Shu, Kobe and Tashigi once again, Nozumi, and many, many more. It should also be noted that captains are the first noticeable ranking in which a Marine is granted permission to lead their own missions and is expected to be able to navigate the dangerous realm of the Grand Line, as well as possess significant combat prowess. Although sometimes people do slip through the cracks in regards to these requirements. Following that, we're starting to get serious now with the fifth highest rank being Commodore. And notable Commodores include Pudding, wait, no, not that one. Yes, this one, that's the Pudding one. The one we've all forgotten about because he's dead. But also the character of Brand New as a Commodore, and demonstrates that this tier of Marines are entrusted with incredibly important duties, sometimes equal to or greater than their superiors. In Brand New's case, he is actually in charge of assigning bounties to the various criminals of the world. Moving up the ranks, we have the ever hilarious sounding position of Rear Admiral, which is Hina's current position, as well as the rank once held by Diaz Drake, back before his rebellious worst generation phase. But stepping up yet again, we have the ranking of Vice Admiral. These individuals are considered to be immensely skilled and powerful, as several of them have displayed a mastery of the Rokushiki techniques, and it is even a requirement that all Vice Admirals must be able to wield at least one form of Haki. Additionally, many Vice Admirals are also granted special authorities, such as John Giant or Monkey D. Garp. And this ranking is also by far the one with the most named characters in the series. I mean, just look at them all, there's so many. But going one more level beyond, we have the ever terrifying rank of Admiral. This is the second highest position in the entirety of the Marines. Marines, and it is only bestowed upon 3 individuals at a time. These candidates must demonstrate exceptional leadership, strategic and combative abilities, and collectively are referred to as the world government's greatest military powers. Furthermore, each of the 3 admirals are given an epithet for the duration of their service. For example, during Kuzan's time, he was addressed as Aokiji, which literally means blue pheasant, while Borsellino's epithet is Kizaru, literally meaning yellow monkey. This naming scheme is always an animal combined with a color that generally reflects the devil fruit abilities of the admiral in question. And as of the time of this recording, only 6 individuals are known to have held the status of admiral in the series, with a bonus non-canon admiral being Zephyr from film Zed. And finally, we reach the pinnacle of commissioned officers with the fleet admiral, who commands the entire marine organization. As such, it is their duty to direct the general mission of the marines and inform the organization's general sense of justice, as well as serve as the military commander in times of war. Thus far, only 3 known characters have held this position, being Sengoku, Sakazuki, and Kong. And 2 of them have since gone on to attain special rankings, which are unique roles given to generally retired Marines to allow them to continue to serve without being required in combat. An example of this would be the Inspector General role, which is charged with investigating corruption, maladministration, or defection within the Marines, and is a position currently held by Sengoku. But there's also the Instructor role, in which a veteran Marine is given the duty of training the future generation. However, there is also one particularly special ranking, known as the World Government Commander-in-Chief. Now, this is more of a political position rather than a military ranking, and yeah, it doesn't technically fit into the Marine organization, but the Commander-in-Chief appears to have incredible levels of authority, as even the Fleet Admiral of the Marines must report to them, and their power is second only to the Gorosei themselves. And at last we saw, which was before the time skip, it was former Fleet Admiral Kong who occupied the role of Commander-in-Chief. Now, with these vast forces, there's a variety of options in which they may be stationed. Starting small, there are many small island bases scattered around the world that ensure protection for other tiny islands within the immediate vicinity. These bases normally have a captain commanding them and are quite common throughout the 4 blue seas. However, larger fortresses do exist within the Grand Line and the New World, which are all dubbed with a G followed by a number. Thus far, in the canon events of the series, we have only seen 4 of these bases, being G1, G2, G3, and G5. So we can probably assume that there is, or at least was, a G4 out there somewhere as well. And these bases are all commanded by an officer of the Vice Admiral rank. But the king of all bases is the central headquarters of the Marines, known as Marineford. This location comprises the bulk of the Marine forces and is situated close to the Red Line in order to present protection for the world nobles who reside above in the Holy Land of Marajoie. As such, it serves as the ultimate stronghold of the organization and is their preferred location to wage war should the occasion call for it, just as it did when it played host to the Paramount War. During this event, one of the 4 emperors, Whitebeard, was provoked into attacking the facility with the entirety of his crew and allied forces, resulting in a war unlike anything we'd seen up to that point in the series. As stated earlier, at least 100,000 Marines were gathered to combat the Whitebeard pirates, and while they did eventually prove victorious, it was a costly battle that almost destroyed Marineford itself. And following Sengoku's retirement, the new fleet admiral Sakazuki elected to transfer Marineford into the New World, replacing the previous G1 base in an attempt to expand their presence within by far the most fearsome and lawless part of the planet. Although with that said, the Marines do still ultimately exist for the purpose of consolidating the power of the world government, and so they are also used extensively as glorified bodyguards for events such as the Reverie, as well as to continually do the bidding of those who are privy to the true secrets of the world. Some more fun facts about the Marines. Despite the fact that the word Marine is romanized heavily in the series, the actual Japanese word for the organization Kaigun more pragmatically translates into the English word Navy. As a result, Viz, Funimation, and 4Kids all opted to translate any instances of the Kaigun kanji into Navy, although depending on what translation we're looking at, instances of the romanized word Marine may or may not have also been changed to Navy. One of the more infamous military operations conducted by the Marines is an action known as a Buster Call, whereby a Marine of high authority, such as an admiral, is given the power to call 10 battleships and 5 vice admirals to completely destroy an island within the world, often committing genocide in the process. In One Piece Green Secret Pieces, it was revealed that the Marines were originally supposed to reflect a mafia-style organization, and aesthetically would be garbed mostly in black, as opposed to the trademark white and navy blues that we see prominently in the series today. And finally, a truly useless fact. In the entirety of the series, we have only actually ever seen one Marine demoted, being former Lieutenant Fullbody, who was smacked down all the way to the rank of seaman recruit due to the fact that he was a dick. But that pretty much does it for the Marines. If you enjoyed this video and the content this channel produced in general, then please do consider donating to the Grand Line Review Patreon, because the support of all of you amazing people is what continues to make this channel possible. Also, do check out my Teespring store if you're interested in shirts, hoodies, and other miscellaneous items, with the proceeds going directly to support the channel as well. And if you'd like to join the fun at any time, then please do head over to my Discord server, where a wide array of shenaniganry takes place on a daily basis. And finally, please do comment with who, what, or where you'd like to see featured in the next One Piece 101.